We have nothing to show.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much for having us both. It's my great pleasure to chat with Chuck Porter of Crispin Porter & Boguski. Chuck is a legend in this industry, and he's done a ton of work, particularly in the United States, that is completely unforgettable. I think Subservient Chicken is certainly my favorite, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. And what I wanted to do is just talk to you about why the work you do is so different, because the best work you have done does not really involve advertising. And when you come to a conference like this, you know, tech-oriented conference, obviously, usually the last thing that people want to talk about is advertising and branding. It seems it's very old-fashioned. It involves legacy media. No one here cares. Everyone knows you can get reach and scale on the internet without hiring an ad agency. You guys are totally upending that model, and I'm wondering if we can start off, if you tell us a story about what you did for Kraft Mac and Cheese in America, because that was an extremely original idea with a very bold client.
Yeah, there's really a lot of people here. You know, the one right before us was about fashion, and maybe you're in the wrong place, because this is clearly not about fashion, so feel free. The Kraft thing. Kraft Mac and Cheese, does anybody know Kraft Mac and Cheese? If you're from the US, you know Kraft. They sell about 200 million boxes a year. Anyway, they're a client of ours, and they came to us a few months back and said, we're gonna change the recipe for Kraft Mac and Cheese. We're gonna take out all the artificial ingredients, and it's gonna be all natural. And we wanna do a big advertising campaign that says, wow, we're taking out. So we went and talked to their customers, and their customers said, if you change the recipe, I'll never buy it again. It's the only thing my kid will eat. Don't change the recipe.
So this is a very American thing, right? In which people do not want the natural ingredients.
Well,
they want
it's not
the chemicals.
It's not that. It's just that people who love this product love it. So we went back to Kraft. And I have to make a confession here, because I have a really, really funny video, a few of them. And it didn't get downloaded, so I have to show you pictures of it. Can you guys see these? Maybe not.
Yeah, move in.
Anyway, so we went to Kraft and said, okay, here's maybe a more interesting idea than doing a big ad campaign that says we're changing our recipe. What we said was, don't say anything. Just don't say anything. Change it and don't say anything. And obviously the ingredients on the box changes, but nobody reads the box. So they did. They changed the recipe, and they waited 3 months, and they didn't say anything. And after 3 months, and after they had sold 50 million boxes of the new recipe, they finally announced it. And it became huge in terms of viral media. All of the, you know, Colbert's a late night guy. Colbert did 2 minutes on it, and basically what he said is, nobody wants to buy Kraft Mac and Cheese if they change their recipe. But here's what happened. They changed it, and they changed it 3 months ago, and you bought 50 million boxes, and you didn't even know. So it was kind of an interesting thing to do. They were prepared.
Was there any resistance from consumers once they found out that basically they'd been fooled?
No. I think that in the first 24 hours after the news broke, 200 million conversations in social media started about Kraft Mac and Cheese. Overwhelmingly positive because people still liked it. People didn't know it. It was interesting also for the client, because the client was prepared to spend a lot of money on this We've Changed the Recipe campaign, and all we ended up doing was running one print ad that said, we'd invite you to try it, but you already have.
Did the client take some persuading? Because this is the kind of, clients in my experience are very risk averse. They're very conservative. The last thing you would want to suggest to most clients is play a big trick on all your customers. Did they have any angst or anxiety before you guys did this?
They took some persuading, yeah. Well, I mean, it's a big deal, you know. Here's this product, and, you know, there had been some negative stuff because they had artificial stuff in it, orange crayons and stuff like that. So they thought it was a big deal, but yes, so they took some persuading, but it was an enormously successful venture. So it's really what it's about What we believe is never start with advertising, and what you do is way more important than what you say. I don't believe traditional advertising is gone. I don't think if you're in traditional advertising, it's all going to go away and your kids are going to starve and you're going to live under a bridge. There will always be traditional advertising because brands need it. But I think that other ways of telling your story are becoming more and more important. I mean, how many people here have downloaded an ad blocker app to your phone?
Ad blockers on your phone?
It's an amazing, because I mean, the latest data says that it's way over 50% of the people who have mobile phones have downloaded an ad blocker app. I don't think it's going to change. I think there will always be a role for traditional advertising, but I think it's becoming more important. What clients do has become more important.
Could you talk to us a little bit about Domino's Pizza? Because you did, in some ways, almost a more extreme version with that client, when you also discovered that, this was many years ago now, but Domino's own customers actually really kind of hated the pizza?
Well, I mean, we worked with Domino's for a long, long time, and they knew that. I mean, it was interesting, because when we first pitched Domino's long ago, we said to them, you know, here's where your food ranks. Here's where your food ranks in terms of the competition. And it was at the bottom, but we said to them, the good news is, here's who else ranks there, and it was McDonald's. So the reality is, people don't just choose things based on the, but they always knew they had to change their recipe. So ultimately, they did change their recipe, and they were also going to do a campaign that basically said, new and improved, we've got a new recipe. And what we convinced them to do, which I think was very effective, is we convinced them to admit that their old pizza sucked. And we did commercials where they said, they had focus groups of people saying, this pizza is terrible, it tastes like cardboard. And then we redid the recipe. And what we did is we actually went to these people's houses who were in the focus groups with the new pizza. They didn't know we were coming. We knocked on the door and said, are you the one who said the pizza crust tastes like cardboard? And the people were like, oh my God, I didn't know. And we gave them the new pizza and said, what do you think now? And it was pretty successful.
And this was part of the campaign. Like, you put
this
media
was
behind
the campaign.
This. Like, Domino's own customers saying on a video,
yes.
This
yes.
is cardboard, it's terrible.
Yes, that was the
campaign. That client must have taken some persuading.
Well, they did. You know, I mean, obviously, nobody wants to say, okay, our product's not very good. But I think that they understood the value of transparency. I mean, the reality is, transparency is the new black. You know, everybody knows everything. And if you're not transparent, you'll get transparented. So we said, why pretend? You know, why say our pizza was really good, now it's even better? Why not say it wasn't very good, so we're making it better? People will believe you. And they did. And I think for Domino's, they've really been an interesting partner, because an awful lot of what we've done since then is really to make them a technology company. We've made it real easy to order. We've created all kinds of, we call it anywhere. Basically, whatever you're doing, you can order a Domino's pizza. We created a little emoji that's a pizza slice that actually won a titanium at Cannes. It's probably the smallest thing that's ever won a titanium at Cannes. And now we've worked with Domino's. We're inventing it was their idea, and we've helped them create it, a pizza delivery car, a specially designed pizza delivery car that are operating in the U.S. now. So we've done a lot of stuff with Domino's.
What does this car do? It, like, keeps pizza hot on the way?
It keeps the pizza hot. Well, we work with General Motors and also with a custom car company in Detroit. And it's based on a General Motors car, but it's got a warming oven, and it's designed to deliver pizzas. And it's another example of what you do is more important than what you say. And also, it's a traveling advertisement. Rather than having a sign stuck on the roof, here's this pizza car.
Yeah.
So it's
how many of those were made?
Sorry?
How many were made?
I don't know exactly. I know that they're in a second run of production right now, but what happens is their franchisees buy them and use them in their, you know, in their franchise market. So I can find out.
Okay.
I'll email all of you and tell you how many were made.
Okay. So what's interesting about this is that these are very product focused ideas. They're not about paid media, they're not about TV advertising, they're not about buying posters or pages in magazines and what have you. And this, I think, is very much a theme in Crispin Porsche-Bogusky's work. Why don't you tell us about what the new work you're launching for Carlsberg and Liverpool FC?
Carlsberg Beer, okay. Carlsberg Beer is a client of ours in Copenhagen, at our office in Copenhagen. Our office in Copenhagen, I love Copenhagen. It's like 12 people, and they do really, anyway. They've had Carlsberg for a while, and Carlsberg sponsors Liverpool Football Club, which, if you're a Brit, you either love or hate, I suppose. Anyway, they have sponsored Liverpool football for 25 years, and this is the 25th anniversary of their sponsorship. So Carlsberg said, we want to do a campaign saying we've been here for 25 years and been a sponsor. So we went back to Carlsberg and said, we have maybe a more interesting idea. Let's create a special greenhouse at our research facility in Copenhagen. And what they did is they built this greenhouse where they raised the hops to put in the beer. They used dirt from the actual football field. I think it's called
Anfield.
Anfield. They used dirt from the actual football field in Liverpool to grow these hops, and they surrounded the greenhouse with huge screen TVs, and they broadcast Liverpool football matches for the last 25 years in full sound and full picture to the hops. So as the hops were growing, they were surrounded by Liverpool football, and they were growing in the soil of the Liverpool field.
And hops don't mind watching television while they grow.
Well, I mean, the hops were watching television. And, you know, it's too bad. I wish we had the video because it's very thrilling. And there's going to be trouble when I get home. But anyway, we don't have the video. But what happened was they grew these hops, and they used these hops that grew surrounded by Liverpool to make this special edition 25th anniversary Liverpool football beer, which just was introduced 2 weeks ago. And apparently the Liverpool football site is like the fourth most popular sporting organization football site on earth. And if you go there, you can see the video that the people at my office neglected to send to Lisbon.
So because a lot of your campaigns are very product oriented and they're about creating new products or changing the existing product or taking the existing product and turning it on its head, your agency now functions almost like a startup, or perhaps more of a startup incubator, in the sense that you have actually created several brands, and your employees have equity in those brands. Tell us about Angel's Envy, the bourbon you created.
We started doing this probably about 7 or 8 years ago. I mean, we said, like every other agency, so we said, you know, we're really good at making brands famous. Maybe we should have our own brands and make them famous. So we partnered with some people that we had worked with in the past, and we created a bourbon whiskey, and it was called Angel's Envy. And we created the brand and the brand story. We found a very brilliant distiller who was quite famous, and he was able to source the whiskey for us, and it was very special whiskey. It was aged in like wine casks. And so we created this brand. And we partnered with some money people, we partnered with some distributors, and we partnered with manufacturers, because we don't know how to make whiskey or distribute it. We know how to brand it. And that was probably about 6 years ago. And it was very successful, and it grew and grew. And then about 2 years ago, we sold it to Bacardi for about $110 million. So we thought, this is cool. So now we're doing about three other liquor brands. We're doing a coffee brand.
Just if I can ask you about that. Sorry. That is an exit right there, right? Because your agency staff
had
equity.
I mean, we didn't own the whole thing because we had all these partners that owned us.
Right, but you have a big piece of equity, and you sell a brand to a larger acquirer, and the valuation is $110 million. And that's what, you know, half the people here are dreaming of, basically.
Well, the reason we did it in the first place is because we're really just a warehouse for creative people. And creative people like to make stuff. And they don't really care if they're making a TV commercial or a whiskey or a chair. They want to make stuff. And so we decided they like to make things. Let's make more things. So right now we probably have about 11 or 12 brands in development. Some are already on the market. Some are close to being, you know, to us exiting. But the agency finds it exciting. And we got to the point where we had about 12 people who were in this development group. And we said, this is terrible because the whole agency. So we dissolved that group. And now different people in different parts of the agency in Miami and Los Angeles and London all work on new brands. And it's pretty exciting. And it's very exciting to think, okay, this new coffee that we're doing here, it's not just a client. We're the client, and we own a piece of it. And that's good for the agency.
And do VCs and startups now approach you?
Yes.
Because that is not, to my mind, you know, that is not normal. Normally, VCs and startups, they tend to stay the hell away from ad agencies.
Well, you know, none of these brands, we haven't really done any advertising. And we do advertising because we like to do it. It never runs. We do it because it's fun. But for the brands that we're creating, they're not really driven by advertising. They're driven by branding, and they're driven by sort of the their business plan. So there's not, so far, we haven't done a lot of advertising for any of these brands.
Is it hard to find clients like that? And again, I keep going back to this risk thing. My experience is that clients are very conservative. They're risk averse. It's no client ever got fired for putting their brand on primetime TV Thursday night, right? You know, is it hard to find good clients like this who are willing to take these risks?
I think clients aren't used to. I mean, we're lucky because some of our clients self-select and they come because we invent stuff and they like that. But for most clients, I mean, you mentioned that subservient chicken thing that we did a long, long time ago. That was for Burger King. We went to Burger King, and it was just to remind people that they also sell chicken because they're called Burger King. We said, we think this would be a cool thing on the World Wide Web, which is this new deal. We think it would be fun. And they're like, just go do TV. So we funded it ourselves. You know, we said, okay, it's going to cost $30,000 to make this. We'll spend the money. We'll put it up. And it got 400 million hits. So then everyone said, well, we want one of those. So I think when
the client only approved it after you'd already paid for it yourself and put it on the web?
We made it and said, we're going to put this up on the internet. And they said, yeah, whatever. I mean, that's kind of where it came from. So we did it. But yeah, that came from us.
Okay. Yeah, the other big difference between Crisp and Porter and Burgosi and other agencies is the level of weird playfulness that you guys bring to this. And again, it's not traditional advertising with a TV and radio and a campaign. It's like, it starts with a really weird idea. How do you, and we got to end now, but how do you build that culture of playfulness?
The reason things go viral, there are three reasons. There's either celebrity or community or unexpectedness. And the last one, unexpectedness, that's why agencies exist. So our whole thing from the start is don't start with advertising and do something surprising. So it's kind of in our DNA to do stuff that's different.
All right. Excellent. I'm sorry we're out of time.
That's all right.
It was a great
pleasure.
Thanks
for coming.
Thank you very much, Chuck. How do we get down?